us this afternoon. We're excited to present a fantastic State of Downtown for you today. And many of you have seen the gentleman to my right. He's a familiar face to many, and he is our new chair of the Downtown Indy Inc. board as of just a few minutes ago. So, Denny, welcome.
Thank you, Sherry. It's good to be back in that role again. And we did just have our board meeting where we elected all of our board members for 2020-2021, as well as the IDMI and our officers and executive committee for 2020-2021. And that took place just prior to this. And I want to especially thank Joe Hogsett. Joe is our outgoing chair, and Joe served us very, very well. He is going to remain on the board. And Joe served us admirably in the city of Indianapolis. Many of you might have seen him at any time riding every day downtown, checking things out. Joe, thank you. And we look forward to hearing from you as we go forward in the upcoming year.
Thanks, Denny. So we have a full program today. We're going to talk about all things downtown. We're going to start off with a welcome from our wonderful mayor, and that will be followed up with the brief discussion from our co-chairs of our Downtown Recovery Committee. We're going to get a preview of our new promotional material that will be rolled out, a campaign that will be rolled out tomorrow. And then we're going to wrap up with a dynamic aspirational presentation from a national leader of and a strong community supporter, Derek Feldman, and he's going to talk a lot about how to make our downtown even stronger.
So we really do have a full agenda, so stay tuned. We're going to work through a lot of material, but none of this would be possible without the support of our presenting sponsor, JP Morgan Chase & Company. And I, at this time, would like for you to welcome the Managing Director and Market Manager from Indiana and Kentucky from JP Morgan Private Bank, Mr. Jim McDonald.
Thank you, Mr. Denny Sponsel. It's a great honor to be welcomed by you, and thank you for all the great work you do in the community, and especially for the United Way in which we serve together. So anyway, as Denny said, I really wear two hats for our bank. One is running our private bank, which serves the needs of wealthy families and individuals throughout the state. And then also, I co-chair our leadership team, which sits aside all of our lines of business and helps coordinate the efforts of our 3,000 employees in the state of Indiana throughout the community. And so on behalf of all of those employees and everyone at JP Morgan Chase, we're really thrilled to be here today for what I think is a very important and timely conversation about something that concerns us all, which is the state and future and the recovery of our great downtown. Downtown has been our city's core. It's really the heart of Indianapolis, and it's also the home of our state headquarters in the Salesforce Tower. And it's no secret that our downtown has been hit really hard by a variety of factors that we're all living with every day. And I think all of us are here today because we're really committed to our city's energy and its livelihood and its future, and really committed to having downtown continue to be a great place to live, to work, and to play in the future. And I'm really proud to say that our bank, which is the biggest bank and the oldest bank in the state, has also been a member of the downtown community in various forms for over 180 years. Really, downtown has been the heart of our presence and everything that we do in banking, and we're completely committed to it and to the future of Indiana and Indianapolis. And it's just great to see so many people participating today, knowing that we're not alone in these efforts. So let me thank especially Sherry, Bob, and the whole team at Downtown Indy for bringing us all together today for this really, really important dialogue on the future and growth and success of our downtown. And I should add, in light of everything that's going on, it's important for us not to just restore downtown to a vibrant place for all the small businesses and all the people that come, but it's important that downtown emerge as a more equitable, fair, and inclusive place for everyone in Indianapolis going forward. It really takes a lot of effort to make that happen. I'm very proud that our bank has been a great supporter of the community financially with a real commitment to inclusive economic growth, and I should say now inclusive economic recovery. And we're proud that every year we commit several $1 million and give that back to the community to help this community thrive. And we're really grateful to work with great partners like the Indy Chamber on their rapid deployment of the Small Business Recovery Fund. Recently, we partnered with United Way on their COVID Emergency Relief Fund. We're working with just a host of institutions across the community, and Downtown Indy is one of them, I'm proud to say. Before I hand it over, in talking about Downtown Indy, or for those of you who have been around for a long time, you might recall its original nomenclature, IDI, I would be remiss if I didn't mention our own great Al Smith. I'm sure Al is not a stranger to anyone on this call, but I just want to highlight that Al really goes back as a founding member of Downtown Indy. And right now, Al is the co-chair of the Downtown Recovery Committee. He's been a great bridge builder. Some of those organizations I've mentioned, he's pulling together and helping them work with Downtown Indy. And he is just doing an outstanding job and just showing the tremendous leadership he's shown over the many years in which he's served this community and helping us now in a moment when we really need his help most. So I just want to give that special acknowledgement to Al. So to close, this has been a challenging time. The pandemic, the tension, the issues around racial justice have created a really challenging environment as we try to move forward as a community. But we've always been a city that comes together and rises to the occasion. And I'm confident by locking arms, we will come out of this stronger than ever. And so on that, I think the conversation, the dialogue we're about to hear is could not be more timely. And there's no one better to lead this discussion than our own mayor. So I'd like to hand it over to a man who needs no introduction, the masked man, the Honorable Joe Hogsett. Great to see you, Mayor Joe.
Well, thank you, Jim. And certainly, it's good to hear from you and from one of downtown's most cherished partners, critical partners, J.P. Morgan Chase. I also want to take the opportunity to thank Sherry and the team at Downtown Indy, as well as Denny. Congratulations, Denny, on what I think I overheard was your re-election. I've been through a couple of those myself. So good luck as you lead our organization to even greater heights than what Indianapolis has already enjoyed. I'll be brief. We are confronting as a nation, as a state, and yes, as a city and as a downtown, an era that is without precedent. A global pandemic and public health crisis, coupled with a long overdue national reckoning with racial injustice. And these challenges have produced perhaps the most trying 6 months in our city's 200-year history. And for those of us who have watched downtown evolve over the last 40 years in particular, it has been painful to see so much growth temporarily halted in the face of these challenges, especially when so much driving these circumstances is beyond the control of city and civic leadership. But we haven't allowed that reality to breed cynicism or fatalism. Rather, as Indianapolis always does, we have risen to the challenge. And over the last several months, we have pumped both funding and resources into the maintenance and repair of our city's economic engine. $37 million in loans and grants for business and nonprofits affected by the pandemic. Road closures, allowing our hospitality industry to safely welcome paying customers. $2 million to reopen the Rubin Engagement Center and to provide non-congregate hotel accommodations for those neighbors of ours who experience homelessness on our streets. $2.7 million in emergency solution grants for rapid rehousing, with $7 million more coming at the end of this month. An expansion of Pathway to Employment, the program that I know you're familiar with, which connects to jobs those who are homeless or who are resorting to panhandling. Added DPW cleaning crews to combat increased littering and expand power washing throughout our key public corridors. Added public restrooms throughout the Mile Square and hand washing stations. And last week, I announced that the city is making an additional $750,000 investment in health and safety measures for the Mile Square. That means an increased investment in non-public safety personnel to serve as wayfinders and ambassadors. It means new technology capabilities to help our law enforcement professionals to come better access and respond in real time to illegal activity. And it comes in the form of more cleaning capacity for our common areas. So let me thank outgoing board chair Joe Hogsett and the Rebuilding and Recovery Committee co-chairs Tom McGowan and Lacey Johnson for their work to champion these programs. I also want to take time to thank the chair of the Capital Improvement Board of Marion County, Melina Kennedy, and the executive director of that Capital Improvement Board, Andy Mallon, for agreeing to administer these public investments. Without their leadership, these new programs would not have been possible. And I believe more than ever, these efforts and efforts like the ones I've identified and the public-private partnerships, which Indianapolis has always done better than any other city in the country, they have always fueled downtown's growth and downtown's evolution. And they too are going to lead us out of these troubling times. Put another way, I am confident that the collaboration and the bold spirit that built our downtown will also help us rebuild our downtown on the other side of this pandemic. That's why we've not allowed the challenges of today to distract us from the needs of tomorrow. Bottleworks is leaping out of the ground. Bankers Life Fieldhouse is receiving a transformational facelift. Mixed-use developments continue to be constructed across our city. Plans are underway to rehab the CSX bridges and refresh Georgia Street. And most recently, just this week, the City County Council voted unanimously in committee to expand the convention center by 300,000 square feet, the sixth expansion in that facility's history. Added to that will be a change in the Indianapolis skyline with the construction of new convention headquarters hotels, becoming one of just three Signa brand Hilton hotels in the country. Now, I know what some may say. It's a gamble to plan ahead like this during a pandemic. To me, it seems like a gamble not to. When the day comes, and it is going to come, when that day when visitors can safely return to the tourism centers in America, Indianapolis needs to be positioned as a leader, not a follower. Until then, well, where I come from, we say, don't take your foot off the gas. We must sustain our downtown. We must protect what makes it so special. And yes, we must make this and take this opportunity to make our downtown more inclusive for diverse businesses, diverse residents, diverse talent. By working together and staying squarely focused on those goals, we can ensure that our future, the future of our city, the future of our downtown, will be brighter than it ever has been. I am confident of that. And together with your help, we'll get the job done. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor. It is always good, and it's essential that we have you here for the state of downtown. The fact that we always pull through these things and your encouraging words of let's look to the other side to greater heights that we will reach. And we all have to believe that. And thank you for your leadership. And I appreciate you being here.
Thank you, Denny.
As the mayor said, great focus on downtown's recovery and resiliency has taken place earlier this summer. When Downtown Indy Inc. Formed the Downtown Recovery Committee, and the purpose of that committee was to tackle these challenges that were immediately before us, and they have been working very, very hard. To give us an update on the committee's actions and priorities, we welcome its co-chairs, who will join Sherry in this important and timely report. And at this time, I'd like to welcome back Sherry, as well as the co-chairs, Lacey Johnson and Tom McGowan.
Thank you, Danny. I also want to thank the mayor for his ongoing leadership through these challenging times. We really appreciate it. I wanted to introduce two important men in my life most recently, but now it's just one. Unfortunately, Lacey, we just got word that he wasn't able to join us, but I do want to introduce a fantastic leader of our community who has been an unbelievable help through these challenging times with the downtown recovery, Tom McGowan, who's the president and COO of Kite Realty Group Trust. So welcome, Tom.
Thank you.
So, yeah, Tom, I thought maybe just we could talk a little bit about the Downtown Recovery Committee, its work, maybe, you know, talk a little bit about the structure and the tactics that we hope to undertake.
Sure. Thanks, Sherry. So first of all, let me talk about the group as a whole. We've been very fortunate to assemble roughly 30 committee members who are all very passionate about downtown. Part of our purpose is to pump additional energy and focus into tackling these list of challenges. I think there's no question we understand what's in front of us. So we've assembled a group that clearly understands how to collaborate and work closely with our partner, Downtown Indy, the mayor's office, the city council, IPD, Visit Indy. We even have the support of the state of Indiana, and then all of our relative stakeholders. So that is critical. This group can't replicate efforts. We have to utilize the resources we have. And at the end of the day, this is one team with one objective. We really tackle short-term issues facing downtown because we have those in front of us. But at the same time, we have to keep an eye on the future. How do we not only take on short-term issues, but create long-term sustainable solutions for the many things that we're doing? And it can also be an eye for the future of downtown Indianapolis in 2021 and beyond. I'm going to take a positive approach, similar to what you heard from the mayor. And despite the narrative, despite some negativity, I have been downtown literally the Monday after the COVID issue. The Monday after, we had problems downtown with unrest. And I can assure you, downtown is improving. The cleanliness is improving. The focus is improving. IPD is doing great things. I actually saw some of it on my way over to Sherry's office. Action is underway, and people need to understand that without question. One of the problems that we face as a committee, as a city, is the simple fact that we only have 10 to 15% of our office population currently downtown. That is a dramatic decrease in foot traffic. When you have that decrease in foot traffic, it extenuates the fact that you have a homeless population that may become more visible for the simple reason of the power of numbers. But this committee is positive. This committee is focused. And we understand that this population will come back in one form or another. We understand that sporting events and conventions, they will return. And it's our job to make sure we accomplish as much as possible during this difficult period to be ready for when that time comes. We have to focus on our current issues, but we're going to be ready to come out of this hopefully stronger than ever. And one thing we've talked about, let's not focus our attention on our fall, the punches we've taken. Let's focus on the bounce, and that's what we plan to do.
Well said. So let's go ahead and just give the audience an idea of the downtown recovery, the structure of the committee, but a little bit more so on what each one is working on.
Yeah, so one of the first things we did as a committee is we established some of the key pillars of what needed to be established. That was a collective effort amongst our great committee. And what we did then is we took those and broke them down into three committees. First committee being street strategic and enabling pillars, which the tagline open for business. The second, public health and safety, supportive and safe. And then environmental aesthetics and activations, clean and welcoming. And then finally, we understand that we have to fund and we need promotional support. That will come in the form of what the mayor spoke about, what the state is helping us with, various potential grants, as well as private sector donations. One thing to be clear, though, it's important to always get back to the mission. And I want to make sure everyone understands the mission. Rebuild downtown Indianapolis in a diverse, inclusive, and economically vibrant community for the benefit of all of Indianapolis. So let's move to our next screen, if we could, please. Next slide.
We'll keep talking through the slide.
While we're waiting, I'll continue on. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the first area, which is marked in orange right there. So that is strategic and enabling pillars open for business. This has two great chairs. One was mentioned previously, but Tamara Cypress, Tamara, and Al have just been doing a great job. What a great combination of two leaders to work on this committee. But this is getting into the bare bones of making sure the boards are down, making sure we're making sure that we have these storefronts in the position that we want. And I will tell you, we are going door to door, making phone calls and getting us in a position that the visual reference to downtown is improving. Sherry and I have spoke about this. We think we're somewhere 92 to 93% through this process with great markings and tracking on each and every one. Marketing efforts. You'll hear some conversations about our marketing efforts later in the presentation, but we have some nice energy there as well that will push traffic and patronage. Then a very important component of our committee is develop plans and seek funding to increase the number of Black and other minority-owned businesses downtown. This was identified as a key driver of what we need to do to make this a more inclusive downtown for everybody. Next. The second committee, public health and safety, supportive and safe. This one, the first bullet here, very critical. As we see the amount of homelessness on the Circle and in other portions of downtown, one of the key items that we are pushing, and that is the team collectively, is supportive housing with a medical component for homelessness. That could be a clinic that would address not only mental issues, but also substance issues. We have a broad expectation to try to do that for the first time downtown with energy behind it. Panhandling, we all understand the challenges that brings. We're looking at collective ordinances, legislation. Those have all been working on, but at the same time, we have to find solutions for the individuals. That is the first job. Then we get into that component. Next one, enhanced public safety representation. We are on top of that. Some of the money that was established earlier in this conversation, we are moving forward with better representation, with bike patrols, with ambassador programs, et cetera. You can see that happening right now. Then the safety ambassador program, this is something Downtown Indy has been working on for quite some time. They've done a great job with it. We've gotten IPD involved, and now we have a very clear program that is going to supplement what we have downtown with bike patrols to help reduce. They'll have radios, and it will be another eye and ear downtown. So very, very critical. The next slide. This is environment, aesthetics, and activations. Clean and welcoming, very important. One of the things Lacey Johnson talked about when we first had our initial meetings is, I think many people remember the Bill Hudnut days of the cleanest city in downtown. That seems like an attainable objective, and that is a key pillar of what we want to do. And if you come downtown, you see the spraying, you see the additional DPW groups, we are on our way to making sure that happens. And then beautification initiatives, gardens, all the things Downtown Indy's working on. How do we put more effort, more funds towards that? And then last but definitely not least, create inclusive and diverse events that balance against the safety limitations of the public health crisis. So the last group, which is also a key component, John Licklider is helping us very much on this last part, and that's city, federal, private, corporate, all kinds of sources that are going to be critical as we move forward. So that is the identification of all those groups. One thing I do want to point out is I want to recognize on public health and safety, that is being chaired by Deputy Chief Barker and Lacey Johnson. I got to tell you, if you ever wonder if there's a disconnect between what we're doing and IPD, I can assure you that is not the case. He is right in with us every day, and he has been a huge help. And then on the clean and welcoming component, that is being chaired by Rick Fusen and Chris Gall. So we appreciate all of those for taking on the committees. Next slide, please.
That's it. So I do want to also talk just a little bit about the campaign that I mentioned early when we first started. We definitely, that subcommittee that is working on communications wanted to be able to, you know, revive the image of downtown. There's been a negative perception related to downtown. We want to regain the confidence of our downtown residents and workers and remind folks that downtown is a beautiful, fun place to come. And so some of our creative friends from Sports Graphic and Studio and Section 127 stepped up. They rolled up their sleeves and they came up with something that I think we will all enjoy. And it's something that we definitely need right now. And it is called Back Downtown.
It's very empty.
It's very empty. No traffic, nothing. It's kind of sad. It's a ghost town.
This is our city. It's time to get back to the heart of who we are. The only way to get back is by working together. We need to take care of our people. We need to take care of our neighborhoods. We need to take care of our streets, our businesses, our sites, and our landmarks, because the heart of Indianapolis is downtown. Back downtown. It's a rallying cry to bring the energy and pride back to the city we love. It's a message that serves to unite us because a unified voice resonates. We're taking measured steps to come back stronger than ever. Through this initiative, businesses can come together to bring people back to our stores, restaurants, museums, and parks. And most importantly, to promise that we'll always have each other's backs.
So certainly a strong message to get back downtown and frankly to back downtown. So we're anxious to roll that out. As I mentioned, we'll be rolling that out starting tomorrow. We will be getting it out to all of our civic partners to release on social media. We invite you as viewers to also put it out on your media outlets. In fact, we'll be putting out a toolkit for downtown businesses to also join us around that simple message of back downtown. So Tom, with that, anything else that you would add to the folks that are tuning in today on what else, if you were asked what else people can do, anything else to add?
Sure, I think the big thing is come together. When the going gets tough, the tough get going, and we're in a tough spot. And as a group, all of us, we need to work hard to help bring downtown back. And that may be as simple as encouraging family, friends, and others to return downtown to both small and large businesses, which is critical during this time of low street traffic. There's starting to be new energy about the thought from larger financial institutions, et cetera, about attempting to slowly start bringing the workforce back. We, of course, would like that to occur only on a safe and measured way, but we do need population downtown without question. It will come, but the sooner we get that would be great. And if there's anything that you can see or anything you identify that we can address, please let Downtown Indy know it. Please communicate. That's one of the keys to this committee, is we have to communicate, and we'll work to address it as quickly as possible. But the bottom line is we need everybody in this together.
That's great. Thanks, Tom. I will never be able to thank you enough for the amount of time that you have given to this committee, your leadership, your devotion to just helping bring downtown back. It's admirable, and I'm just forever grateful. So thank you.
Thank you.
I also want to thank the Downtown Recovery Committee as a whole. In difficult times, it's great to be able to see people that do care, that come together, and that want to make a difference. And so everybody on the committee has just been tremendous. I really appreciate their time. And with that, apologies. Here we are. Hi, Denny. And the work behind the downtown agenda certainly continues. Before pre-COVID, as I mentioned, our organization took on a downtown agenda that included six different constructs that we thought were important to downtown, which included homelessness, safety, curb management, affordability, livability. Post-COVID, we've certainly continued a lot of that work with downtown recovery. As we definitely want to take it back and talk a little bit more about the work that had been done with the downtown agenda.
So yeah, Sherry, the downtown agenda was created to provide a blueprint on how to set priorities for this organization. A subcommittee was formed around each topic that Sherry mentioned. And these groups studied the issue, discussed and started to identify short and long-term solutions around each of those areas. Now, clearly, COVID-19 accelerated the urgency for some of the issues, and we'll see that in a moment. But as the Downtown Recovery Committee is focused on the immediacy of what is needed right now, the Downtown Agenda will be the framework and construct to drive us beyond the recovery into 2021 and beyond. So let's take a look at three of these issues and three of these areas on the agenda.
Downtown is a magnet for not just downtown workers or downtown residents, but also, you know, people who visit downtown and frequent downtown for restaurants, arts, the symphony, the Pacers, the Colts. Those are all, it's important for them to understand and appreciate the safety and security, the perception of downtown. Well, the key priorities or strategies of our task force included a perception of safety, and we heard information and data from IMPD that downtown is one of the safest areas of all of Marion County, right? That downtown being a significantly large geographic area, but it only accounts for, on any given year, 3-4% of all the crimes in the county. Our key tactics of our committee for those strategies included expanding the existing street ambassador program to add safety ambassadors to the role of the existing street ambassadors, but also hiring or enlisting others, additional personnel, to be really more safety ambassadors, potentially exclusively. The second item was the B-Link program and connecting up and communicating cameras that are on both private and public property downtown for the city to IMPD primarily to have access to those quick and almost real time. Some of the benefits we've seen of that over the summer have been to ameliorate crime activity that had been increasing on the canal. Got those messages, connected to the cameras, established foot patrol. Downtown is a magnet for not just downtown workers or downtown residents, but also, you know, people who visit downtown and frequent downtown for restaurants, arts, the symphony, the Pacers, the Colts. Those are all, it's important for them to understand and appreciate the safety and security, the perception of downtown. Well, the key priorities or strategies of our task force included a perception of and the neighbors and IMPD downtown to do that at and adopted was addressing aggressive panhandling in the Mile Square and downtown. Well, the thing that gives me hope about our tactics and strategies is first the collaboration with the city, with IMPD, with major corporate and private stakeholders in downtown Indy, as we've come together to talk about this, garage owners and operators, private building managers, all of whom have been concerned and have been great to step up and talk with us. I'm optimistic about how committed downtown Indy, IMPD, our committee and volunteers, residents, property owners, trade associations, restaurants, hotel owners are committed to addressing this problem and making downtown vibrant.
A lot of times people will think the issue of homelessness is straightforward, that someone just lost their job and they're not, maybe they're lazy and go get a job. That's not the case. The issue of homelessness is so complex, and because it's different for every single individual, there's no one right answer. There's no cookie cutter answer. to solve homelessness and the issue of homelessness. So it has to be person by person and tailored. That individual plan needs to be tailored for that person. I think there's a couple reasons why we're perceiving the increase in homelessness downtown. Part of it is that with so much of the workforce working from home, homeless individuals are much more visible. We always find an increase in the summer months of people living outside. It's the weather is acceptable to do that as opposed to when you're in the wintertime and freezing cold. The other thing that we're quite worried about is with the eviction moratorium lifting, right? The rate of eviction and the number of individuals that don't have that support system, they now will be knocking on the doors of many service providers to try and get that help. Because if they have no other option, then they'll become homeless looking for shelter in either one of the overnight emergency shelters, or if we can get them connected with rapid rehousing funds that can get them back into a home, right? What we're trying to do is now figure out on some short-term basis, what can we do as a collaboration between the business owners, the, let's say, street outreach teams and IMPD to really help connect those individuals with the right services. So really understanding, again, the barriers that someone is facing, and then what's the right path, if you will, for that individual to become housed. Some of the barriers that we see individuals facing, one, first and foremost, we see a lot of the individuals, they have no support system. So they may not have any family or friends here that they can lean on if they fall into hard times. You can imagine the number of people today that live paycheck to paycheck. Right, you have one mishap. So your car breaks down, you have a medical condition, something happens. Solutions that we've been talking about, are more IMPD having greater presence both on foot and bike, as well as, some additional cameras for downtown, and then working with having service providers like myself on these committees to really talk about the solutions and the services aspect. I would just ask that everyone remember that we're all human beings. So all of these individuals are a mom or a dad, a son or a daughter, and try and keep the human aspect of it in mind.
So I live in Meridian Kessler for some just short of 30 years. And my wife and I decided that we wanted to live in the downtown and now live in Lockerbie Square and love it. And livability is, I think, critical. That are at 50%. Oops.
I can tell you that those videos, we will have them posted on our website later in the day. They just to give you an idea, that was the work that had been done with our downtown agenda post-COVID. So as you see, many of the issues that we were concentrating on are issues that we're concentrating on even now And all of those issues really relate to having a strong downtown. And we all understand why it's important to have a strong downtown, but we continually ask ourselves, what do we need to do to continually strengthen our beautiful downtown? So we started digging into those questions, and we sought the assistance of a well-regarded, talented researcher and speaker. And he and his team spent several weeks embedded in downtown, and they fully immersed themselves into the street life of downtown last fall. And our plan was to hear their findings from the work that they did this spring, but we're now, of course, all on COVID time. So we have now brought Derek back for our State of Downtown Part 2. And in many ways, what we are learning is that the information that you're going to present is probably even more important today than it was then. Derek Feldman has been recognized as a leading researcher in cause engagement for more than a decade, and his work is regularly cited by outlets such as Forbes and Fast Company and the Wall Street Journal. Derek currently splits his time between Indianapolis-based Influence SG and the Ad Council. Derek is the managing director of Influence SG, a movement design studio working with leading brands and causes to research, ideate, and test new movement approaches. He's an outstanding listener, and he then helps us act on what we have heard. So Derek loves downtown. We know he loves downtown. So Derek, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Well, hello, everybody. Thanks, Sherry, so much. So I have the wonderful position to be in your final 12 minutes. So I realize that probably dinner, work, family, all of this is sort of convening around this time. So I'll try to make it at least worth your while for a little bit here before you get into your evening. As Sherry mentioned, my team and I spent the fall of last year, it feels like forever, trying to understand really about the people who live, work, own businesses, and have corporate employees and leaders, what really is about downtown Indianapolis, this place that they call home, essentially. What is it about this place that each one of those that calls home, home? And essentially, we started out by doing three things, essentially observing, listening, and then understanding, of course. And our goal was really to try to get at the heart of each of these different types of audiences and understanding from their perspective, really what they want to see and what makes it better. Now, obviously, so much has changed. But as I go through some of the key learnings that we sort of gleaned from our time there, and I'll give you an idea of what time I kind of spent over the course of about 2.5-3 months. My team and I attended block parties, visited in homes, went to the west side of downtown Indianapolis, to homes in the south side, and all different types of different areas and locales. We wanted to truly be a part of it. And in order to be a part of it, just like in the work that we're trying to do right now, it really comes down to how well we can listen. Because as I joke with my kids, I can hear them when they're yelling at me, not wanting to kind of clean their rooms, but it may not be something I want to listen to. And so we had to invest in the time in listening to both residents, business leaders, and others to try to get at really what is the reason why they have chosen downtown Indianapolis to be their home. Now, I have to kind of keep this thing in mind as I go through today is we are in this different kind of world from where we were just, 8 months ago. But the spirit of what we delivered actually in the fall about what's necessary, it reads directly into the agenda that you have heard. So I want to share a little bit about that as well. When you are there, when you're listening to people and understanding the residents that live on the west side or by the stadium or those that live in Fountain Square over to Mass Ave and others in Lockerbie as well, you become part of the groups that they have formed too. When you attend and walk to the coffee shops that they did in the fall, or even sit on the porches to yell at somebody else across the street to others who are on their porches and talking about the week and what they're going through, you feel the power of what it means to be a part of something. And we heard that in the livability and some of the other elements we had here. And at the end, it comes down to four simple things that we constantly heard about. The first one I want to cover is the word love. I mean, people love downtown Indianapolis. Now, the interesting thing about loving something, though, is loving something and you're passionate about it also means it requires a lot of attention, and it requires work to keep and maintain that position as well. And hearing today too, and the work that we heard, is that while people really love downtown Indianapolis, whether you're a resident or a business owner or a corporate leader, they also care deeply and are passionate about that place so much that they want to express it and make it even better. And not just last fall, but now, even now, and as we talk about what it looks like in the future. Because for the place that we call home, we are so passionate and we want it to be amazing. We want it to be amazing for our families and for our fellow employees, our colleagues, our business leaders, and those that are also part of this community that we call downtown Indianapolis. We take pride in what that really, really is. But naturally, there is a challenge. When we are so passionate about the love that we have for a city, we sometimes have our blinders on as to what other people have in terms of their own vision. You know, when you're sitting down with residents, whether that's in the Old North Side or whether it's in other areas, you find yourself hearing that their vision for what downtown Indianapolis is or what it should be is similar to others, but sometimes they feel like it's not being heard. And when we are so passionate about the place that we love, we have to keep in mind that in order to develop something better and kind of getting to the next stage of where we need to go, we actually have to listen to other people's visions as well, and keeping that at the forefront of what it means to be together. Now, we always fall in love with our own ideas, constantly. Now, we have to keep in mind though, are those ideas actually adding value to others around us? Are they adding value to downtown Indianapolis, to our businesses, to our residents, our corporate leaders, and our employees? Downtown Indianapolis is home to each of those. And we have to keep in mind that in order to create that common vision, we have to add value to everyone as well. And so my point here is that in terms of thinking about love and the passion that you have for making downtown great, is that we have to keep in mind everybody else's visions as well and make that part of ours too, so that everybody can be a part of what is to be next in terms of downtown Indianapolis. The next word I want to talk about is the word choice. And I think of the word choice because often in our conversations, it would start something similar like this. I've chosen downtown Indianapolis because, and it would go into detail about why downtown is amazing for them, both as a resident, bringing their families or being a part of it, the experience they get to have. Business leaders talking about what it means to have a convention business, as well as residents and others being a part of what they're trying to do and the passion that they bring every single day to their store or other kinds of things that they're offering. Corporate leaders and employees talking about, we've chosen this place because we love it, the experiences offered to employees. That word choice, though, is quite interesting because when I think about choice and we choose things, we go through life and there will be challenges that exist that sort of question our choice from time to time. I mean, each one of us, whether you have kids or not kids, whether you're trying to decide to stay, not stay, invest more, not invest more, decide this week we're going to buy more produce or not because we want to open the restaurant or figure all of those things out, we're making choices. And gosh, myself, even like you at times in this, have sort of looked back and said, is that the right choice? Well, now what we hear and what we're seeing, especially as you heard today from those that are working on what downtown Indianapolis will be after this, is that we're choosing to be a part of that. Every person that we talk to, regardless of the downsides to Indianapolis, downtown Indianapolis, viewed this as a choice worthy of making. And, you know, we flat out have parents who told us, you know what, downtown Indianapolis may not be the best place for us, but we're choosing it anyway. And we, as fellow families, are making this downtown Indianapolis work for us as well. So as I think about choice and what's possible and where the choices that you are making and second-guessing yourselves at times, this is a time not to necessarily second-guess, but think about how you can reinforce that choice and be a part of it. Reinforcing those choices is based upon our own participation in making what we want downtown Indianapolis to truly be. Now, the third thing that really comes to mind is the word that we've already heard about, together. But I want to think about together in a little bit of a different frame and context. when we were spending time with residents, business owners, people that live and work in downtown Indianapolis, they love being together. And obviously this pandemic and the challenges that we're facing right now have sort of kept us socially distanced and isolated at times. But there is a little bit different notion of being together, not just with our loved ones and our family members. Togetherness means walking down the downtown Indianapolis streets and seeing the business owner in the morning and saying hi. It's being in the park and talking with one another just to make sure you're okay. That sort of civic togetherness that we are missing and craving right now at times. While we are together here, obviously on this fantastic call, we would love to have been together in person. The feeling of being together is something that is just so amazing. Now, we have to keep in mind, though, is that togetherness requires places to be a part of, right? Now, we can be together virtually now, but it also requires fantastic places that obviously the committee is working on and others. But one thing that came to mind in being together is not everybody has the kinds of places where they can be together as well. You go to certain neighborhoods, they look upon other neighborhoods and say, boy, how come we don't get that? How come just right over there, it looks much different from my neighborhood? It might be on the west side or the south areas and so forth. And what we heard directly from them is, can we be a part of that too as well? Not just, I'm disappointed, but rather, how can we get that for here? Which just shows, again, the passion and love for what the person has for this downtown Indianapolis. This is a small example, quite honestly, of what it means when somebody wants to not only look at something over there, create their vision, and participate in it too as well. The relationships that we have with one another, whether, again, it's walking and seeing just that fellow business owner, getting that cup of coffee, and interacting with one another will come again. We have to keep in mind, though, is that not everybody has that same experience. And not everybody can be together in the physical places yet, because they may not have those. The coffee shop, because they don't have the green space, is their physical space that hasn't been open. They haven't been able to share and convene like they really, really wanted to. So as we build the next iteration, I want you to think about how our efforts of being together is that we're being mindful of areas within downtown neighborhoods that don't have those sort of places and things that allow them to be as together as certain other areas too. And we work with them as well as they work with us to create that vision of what it will be. I want to end here, because I know, again, you've got things that you need to attend to as well, with one major word, which is around a word that we heard a lot, which is around being valued. Every employee, every person listening in, every resident wants to feel like they're a part of something and that they also add value in that they're respected and valued in there too. You know, they are working towards this vision overall of what downtown Indianapolis could be. And I'll be honest, in the fall, we heard that not everybody heard that they were valued. You know, people in certain parts of downtown Indianapolis didn't feel that same value as others. And this isn't new. This has been something that we know, and the committee is working hard, obviously, to incorporate more inclusive opportunities as well. What's fascinating, though, as somebody said to me in all of our conversations, is we are an amazing city. We are an amazing place. We're an amazing downtown. And the reason that we're very different and diverse is the thing that makes us even more amazing. The fact that we're there and that these people are there makes it kind of this downtown Indianapolis, the exciting, the vibrant, the experience, the livability of who we are. But we have to work hard, obviously, to make valuing and ensuring that each person feels valued and is a part of our community as well. Now, as we kind of think about the future, and as we think about this next iteration, I want to kind of give you a couple insights about the path ahead from our perspective, again, from the time that we've been spending. I often talk about the path of least resistance overall. And quite honestly, our brains are operating in that way. We are constantly trying to figure out ways to do the least to get the most out of it all the time. I mean, this holds true. The first week in January, one of the most Google search terms is, how do I lose weight and not exercise? I mean, I'm with you. We try to find the shortcuts at times to get the most impact as possible. We call this the path of least resistance. Now, we really need to move beyond the path of least resistance, because it's not going to be easy. It's going to be work, but it's going to be great work. This plays out in everything that we want to do with our path ahead. And in the path ahead, I ask you to consider a couple things based upon what we had heard, is that we really have to work on a path that reinforces what we love and why we chose here, right? Being together, those things that I've discussed. Because as every successful venture, I know that every single one of my business leaders and corporate leaders that are on here right now, we have all listened, created, failed, developed, reiterated, launched again. There will be some missteps along the way, but as long as there's that shared vision, of course, we will demonstrate together that we have a shared value and that we also have a shared vision. While it might look different, we're not interested in caring about one versus the other, but actually together. Forging on this path ahead actually demonstrates, if we do it, we'll demonstrate that we actually all do feel like we belong. It feels good to feel like you belong to a place that you call home, essentially. And that is why so many have actually chosen this route as well. We have to recognize too that we, you and us, right? Residents, business owners, corporate leaders, their own employees too, is that the path ahead that we're leading towards can be a part of our lives, right? It is a part of what we value. And we hold it really, really high. And therefore, this is something that we should be a part of. And we should be heard in that conversation too. So as I ask, as you kind of go forward, that longstanding issues are still going to exist and we're going to work really hard to try to address that. But we need to work on these short-term milestones that kind of get us from making and helping us feel that we're a part of something as well. And that truly happens when you recognize and you listen, when you truly listen to people and understand their vision and seeing how your vision is a part of it too. So I end here with you as well in saying that we each have some great shared experiences that reinforce our love and why we have chosen downtown Indianapolis. And I know everybody listening cares deeply, because you wouldn't be here on a Thursday afternoon. It's 5 o'clock and so many things are happening in the background, I know, given that you're probably working from home and listening on your device. But keep this in mind, that so many people are passionate and they value this downtown Indianapolis. They might show it in different ways, but they actually have a common agenda like you as well, which is downtown Indianapolis next will be even better than where it is now. I thank you and appreciate the time.
Derek, thanks so much. Your enthusiasm, your insight and perspective is always greatly appreciated. And when you look at our downtown around those four words of love, choice, together, and people feeling valued, it's a perspective we can look at. And your insight is always welcome. So thank you so much for being with us today. Well, everyone, we're now in the home stretch. And I want to let you know that the videos, the link will be sent to each of you. There was a Zoom glitch, technology, right? I think we're all very familiar with that. You know, today we have talked about some of the most pressing issues that we're facing and what is being done about those. We know that the challenges are big, but we know we're up for the challenges. Indianapolis always is. We have heard what many are already doing to help downtown succeed and exceed expectations, both short-term and long-term. We've heard from the mayor on how together we will preserve and strengthen our downtown, and as he said, go to new heights. There truly is momentum already. Tom McGowan mentioned it. There are things that are on the move now and are happening. Tomorrow, over 100 community leaders are going to gather on Monument Circle and go about downtown to help clean up downtown and put a shine on our downtown. And I can tell you, our foot is on the pedal. All of us can help in this. All of us should help in this. We need your help. As I mentioned, these challenges are big. And some of the fixes are going to be some big fixes that need to be there. But I want you to keep in mind that much can be accomplished when we all do a little. Whether it is how you personally dine, your personal support and encouragement, your personal support and expenditures with retailers downtown. Much can be accomplished when we all do a little, and that is a call to action. Everyone, thank you so much for joining us today, and let's get back downtown.